not time to start yet, but last year, those of you who might remember me from last year, I took some questions before my talk, and it can be about anything you're interested in. I'm an ex-police officer who's I'm a college professor right now. I teach criminal justice. So if anyone has a question about anything, what I'd like you to do is just step to the mic and ask the question. The only core requirement I have is I need you to say hypothetically, and the reason for that is here in Nevada I do not have a law license, and it's actually a crime to give legal advice outside their state that you're licensed in, and so you're either gonna have to say hypothetically or you're gonna have to say this happened in Missouri. That's where my license is at. I'll start off with I had a couple questions last year. And if you're that guy or guys who ask those questions, you know, raise your hand. We won't laugh at you. But the strangest question I had last year was, what do you know about black helicopters? And I have no idea why that guy thought I had the inside track on black helicopters, except I did spend some time in Wyoming. And at the time, he just sort of threw me off. I didn't really have an answer. And actually, I do have an answer now, okay? The black helicopters do exist. What I did was, out in Wyoming, some of you guys know that that's the last areas we still actually have missile silos. And these missile silos are just out in the middle of nowhere. You'll be driving along. Usually you're going to need four-wheel drive. But you drive along and all of a sudden you'll run into a missile silo. It'll just simply have a chain link fence around it and some barbed wire on top. And I'll have some cameras and surveillance equipment, that type of stuff. But you can go right up to the fence. And the only black helicopters I know that actually exist, according to the sheriff deputy I talked to out in Wyoming, is those who respond to people who go and look at these missile silos up close. Because you can walk right up to them and within 20 feet of them. And they're pretty secure, obviously, because they're designed to withstand an atomic blast. So there's not a whole lot that any of us could actually do to the silo. The other strange question I got, and it made me kind of paranoid, was a young man who walked up and told me that he wanted to rig his computer up to destroy his hard drive. And he began to ask me about the various techniques to do that. And some of them were pretty grand. Is he here today? Using thermite. Which I don't know anything about thermite, but he began to describe how he wanted to use some thermite to take care of his hard drive if the feds ever kicked his door in. And I really didn't have an answer. I knew it was something that'd probably get him in trouble, obviously, and I told him that. But I did look into that, and it is wrong to rig your computer up with thermite, okay? And actually, it's going to be a couple different felonies there. It's probably a lot better to get caught with whatever you have on your hard drive than to start rigging devices like that to it. Okay.
Why is it illegal?
Why is it illegal?
Hypothetically,
why is it illegal? Anytime you knowingly destroy evidence at the federal level, I don't have the statute in front of me, but any feds here want to help me out? Anytime that you knowingly destroy evidence, even if that evidence is your evidence, such as your hard drive, it's a felony. And usually it is punishable by a sentence that is heavier than the crime that you're probably guilty of, unless it's something like child porn, and we don't have none of those freaks here today, right? But if you're just a common hacker, not even a common hacker, you're a criminal hacker, probably the charges are going to be put against you would result in lesser of a jail sentence than if you did rig your hard drive with some kind of device, and they could prove it, that you rigged it, for destroying evidence. Any questions at all? I would say hypothetically that it would become evidence just as soon as any evidence of a crime exists on it. And I know that doesn't answer your question real well, but if you're out there and you obviously have some kind of track you lay down out there that is going to be used against you, and you destroy that, you could be fined, imprisoned. I can't hear whoever's in back. You're going to have to come up to the mic.
She asked, what about the Fifth Amendment?
Self-incrimination, I assume, is what she is talking about. You have the right to remain silent, but you don't have the right to destroy evidence. It's real, I mean, that's pretty clear. Yes. Well, I would say this. His question was, what if you did a low-level format, right? Is that? I guess the point you're wanting to make is if I destroy it, but just don't do a good enough job, and the feds can retrieve it, am I still going to be in trouble for the act? Hypothetical. The answer is yeah. I mean, it's there's a reason why they write the laws like this, right? Because they want to make sure all the wiggle room is taken out. There's no way to escape. There's no way to get out. And you know, just a side note, everyone in here knows it's if you're talking to a federal agent and you lie to them, right, it's a crime. So I mean, they do this for a living. They got it figured out how to keep you from getting too far loose. Yes.
It's a crime to want the right to remain silent. You need to give up your passport.
You know, there's some cases on that, and I can't give you an answer. I'm sorry. I'd hate to tell you yes or no when you go do one of the two. And you know, that's the way I'm leaning. They can force you to give up your password. Anyone know for sure? Anyone have that happen to them? I think you can. Yeah.
You say it's a crime for us to lie to a federal agent, but is it a crime for a federal agent to lie to us?
Okay, everyone hear that? It's a crime to lie to a federal agent, he said, which is true. Is it a crime for a federal agent to lie to you? And the answer is, in most cases, no. Okay? There's actually a Supreme Court case out there that says a cop can lie about just about everything. The only thing they can't, basically, I mean, there's a few other exceptions we'll go into, but basically, the only thing they can't lie to you about is telling you got a deal. Okay. In other words, they can't say, "Oh, why don't you talk to me? I'll make sure that you never spend a day in prison." Okay. Well, unless they know for certain that that's the case, and that, you know, they can't tell you that to compel you to talk. They can't do that type of. They can do anything else they want. Okay. Yes. Hypothetically.
Most people have told me that the best solution, I've usually been coached, is to just be quiet. Not say anything for as long as you can, and just spill coffee as much as you can.
I don't know if I'd spill coffee.
Agitates them.
Well, I can't see him keep giving you coffee. You know, here, spill this one. I don't think they'll do that. But yeah, I mean, 99% of the cases, and some attorneys will say, "What do you mean, 99% of the cases?" 99% of the time, not even that. 95% of the time. It is in your interest to remain silent. Now, some of you are going, "Well, what's the other 5%?" Okay. Uh-oh, the DEF CON guys.
We'll get you started.
Okay, we're ready to start. But let me finish this question, because you guys are dying to know the other 5% of the time. Okay, the other 5% of the time, and this is kind of, I mean, you won't like it, but this is reality. When I was a police officer, I was a detective for a little while, and you guys all know it's very common practice to give deals to the first person that talks. If you're in it with a group of people, okay, you've committed a crime and they rounded you all up, usually the first person that gives it up, sometimes the first two, that person is going to get a deal. Okay? And some of you go, well, that sucks, man. That's not right. Narking me out. That's a reality. I don't care. I mean, I've seen thousands, maybe not thousands, but hundreds of criminals come before me, and it's usually a race. Okay, it is a race to see who can get the deal first. And if you don't believe me, just read the newspaper. Okay, talk to people who you know that have, in fact, been arrested, and they could be on either side of that. Whoever got the deal first is probably the person that talked. Okay, now I'm not telling you go do it because it's, you know, it's a crapshoot, right? I've seen brothers give up brothers, husbands and wives give up each other. Jail is not a nice place to be. Okay. All right, I'll try to take some more questions at the end if there is any, I don't know. But the clock on the wall says it's time to learn about the Census Bureau.
And all Q&A has to be from the mic after this.
Okay. He says any questions and answers has to be from the mic. And I fear him, so we better not do it. All right, my name is Steve Dunker. A little bit of background about myself. I am a former police officer. I currently teach at Northeastern State University, which is a regional university there in Oklahoma. Okay, I teach criminal justice. I am an attorney. And that's probably the easiest way to explain how I even stumbled on this topic. I was sitting in my office one day doing what college professors do, and actually that day I was playing video games. And I got a phone call, and it is one of the phone calls that attorneys really don't like. It was a phone call from a relative in trouble. Now, of course, relatives, we know, don't pay, okay? And they always get mad at you, and then you gotta go at Thanksgiving and Christmas, and they frown at you and act like that you've shot their dog, right? So anyway, in this particular case, it was my sister, okay? Now, if we got any attorneys in the office, you go, oh, you're talking about a case, you're, you know, violation of confidentiality. One of the rules I have is, if I take your case, I get to tell everybody about it. And if you don't like that, don't take me as your attorney, right? So they understand the confidentiality is gone, pretty much, except for, you know, super secret stuff. Because I do seminars and talks like this. And so she calls me up and she says, Steve, they're going to put me in jail. And I said, well, being a good brother, well, what'd you do? You know, because I figured she did something, you know. But no, she's about 47 years old. She's not really a troublemaker, right? She's a mom and all this other stuff. And basically what happens, she says, it's the Census Bureau. And all I could think is, what? The who? And she says, a Census Bureau. And I said, well, what happened? She goes, well, they sent me this form to fill out in the mail. And it's really long, and it has 36 questions for each member of the household. I said, yeah. She goes, and it asks these really personal questions, even stupid stuff like, what time do I go to work? How do I get there? What is my electric bill? And so on and so forth. And we'll get to those questions here in a little while, okay? And she said, and it was invasion of my privacy, and I told this, when I first got the form, I ignored it. You know, I just threw it away. I wasn't gonna fill that out, okay? And I'll tell her you clapped. Maybe she'll like me at Thanksgiving more or something. Anyway, so I said, okay, so where's the jail part come in? She goes, well, then I started getting phone calls. And I said, okay, well, what happened in these phone calls? And she said, well, the first time I picked it up, and I said, we're from the Census Bureau, and you haven't turned in your form, and we need to complete that form. We can do it by phone right now if you want to. And she told me, well, no, that's evasion of my privacy. I'm not going to do it. I refuse to participate, you know, or words of that sort. Okay, and then she said, by the way, how did you get my phone number? Okay, and according to her, these are their exact words. The person on the other end of the line says, we're the government, we have our ways. Okay. Now, most of it's going, oh, you know, you can Google people's name, you can get their phone number that way. But you have to understand, my sister does some work from home, and her boss put in a phone line just for her to use for her computer and for business-related information, okay? Well, it's not in Google, I checked, okay? It's not in any of the other search engines, I checked. And somewhere, you know, I don't know what she filled out, but somewhere, someplace, somehow, she must have filled out the form or something that somehow linked her name to this phone number, or the government is really super good at getting phone numbers. I don't know. Anyway, so she called me up, and after the second phone call, they sent a person out to visit her. Okay, and this person knocked on her door and said, "Hi, I'm from the Census Bureau." And my sister said, "I'd have told you I don't want to talk to you." And then this person put a little bit of pressure on her. "Well, if you don't talk to us, we're going to have to notify the U.S. Attorney's Office." My sister said, "What?" They said, "If you don't talk to us, if you don't give us the information, we're going to have to notify the U.S. Attorney's Office that you're refusing to fill out the census form, and therefore you'll be in violation, and you can get in trouble." Now, of course, my sister, you know, the U.S. Attorney's Office, you know, the prosecutor for the federal government. And so that's when she decided to call me. Now, that's probably your biggest mistake. People are going, "Yeah, you know, what can I do? You know, do I have to write to me and sign?" Your biggest mistake is not calling an attorney right away. Okay, if she would have called me right away, of course, she didn't know it was going to blow up like this. We could have solved it pretty quick, probably. And you guys would learn how to end. So anyway, I start my work as my sister's attorney, and I start researching this. And the one thing I noticed, and you guys will see in a little while, is that there is not a whole lot of law out there as far as case law or incidents of this sort, and it is kind of rare for this to happen. Anyone in here have the Census Bureau on your butt ever? Anybody? Okay, I got a couple people. Talk to me after, if you got the time, okay? I just like to hear some stories, and other than just this one I'm working on, the cases I found. But let's go ahead and do some background, because that's what you're here for, right? The Census Bureau is a U.S. government agency. That quote I had up there for such a long time is directly from the U.S. Census webpage. And they're, I don't know if I'd call it bragging, but they're the one, you know, they've made the statement, we're the ones with information on every single person in America. Now, if you think about it, even the IRS don't have that, okay? But they have it, supposedly. There's two types of census forms you might run into, and that's a census that they give out every 10 years. There's a long form and a short form, and then there's one called American Community Survey, and that's what my sister ran into. And it is, from what I looked up, every year a tenth of the population gets this American Community Survey. It's about 36 pages long, somewhere around in there, and ask a lot of those questions. And they also do some other surveys we won't get into. It is in the Constitution that the government has to do a census, okay? And basically what it says is every 10 years the government will do a census of the population. And the basic reason for this was to figure out how to get representation in Congress, right? Because if the population shifts, we may have to redraw some district lines as far as congressmen. Okay, well, in the beginning it was, you know, a good thought, but since that time, and actually immediately after, you know, in the early 1800s, it was, you know, we like to think, oh, that's a better time, there wasn't so much invasion of privacy, but you'd be wrong. They ask many of the same questions today, obviously not about the modern conveniences, but they ask a lot of the same questions today as they did in the 1800s. Census compliance, 67% of the people in the USA fill out their census forms. This is actually down, and it's probably good news, right? Usually it goes the other way. We've got a lot of sheep out here in America, and they just blindly fill out the forms. But it's going the other direction now. They're actually losing for some percentage points. Here's some of the questions that's on. I broke them down in four categories. This is the first one. And these are some of the questions they ask. Now, when we first look, it's not a big deal on some of these questions, right? You know, can they really use the fact you're married against you? Well, I don't know. But as you go through there, I mean, the one that really, or the two that really stands out there is the ones I bolded, you know, place of birth, citizenship, year of entry, language spoken. Obviously, if you are from the Middle East, you probably feel a little bit uncomfortable filling that out, right? Economic characteristics of the population, and we go on, we can see there's various other things. Occupation, class of worker, income, you know, anyone fear the IRS? I mean, you're giving this, your income to the government. Can they access it from the IRS? Well, we'll talk about that in a minute. Physical characteristics of housing seems pretty benign, but we'll see later on this is actually can be used against you. Financial characteristics of housing, blah, blah, blah. In the past, we have seen some use of the census that can be questionable. That's why I put myths up there. Besides the Nazi thing there, it depends on your viewpoint whether or not this was good or bad use of the census. For example, Sherman's March to the Sea. Now, any Civil War buffs will tell you this was actually a huge event, especially for Georgia and South Carolina. In fact, they have just now actually recovered, and this sounds kind of silly, but Sherman's March to the Sea was one of the first times that the American Army actually employed tactics against civilians. Okay, and basically what happened in Sherman's March to the Sea, we're talking General Sherman, he took his army and cut a 50-mile wide path through the middle of Georgia. Okay, and later on he did it to South Carolina. And when I say when he cut a path, it was he burned down everything that was of economic value. Okay, so if you imagine someone coming through wherever you live and they burned down every factory, they burned down every, well back then, you know, we're talking grist mills and sawmills and any other type of economic possibility out there. They burned it down, okay? They destroyed it all. And they also took everything from everyone. You know, we see some of the Civil War movies like Cold Mountain or something like that. The Union troops show up and they just take all your livestock. In fact, that's where the census comes in. General Sherman had to find a path. He decided he was going to take this move. Abraham Lincoln said, yeah, go ahead and do it. And he had to feed his army off the land. And one of the things he did, he got out the census forms for that area, and he studied it. And he said, where can I go to feed my army? And he used the information from those forms to direct his path. And in fact, by the, he talks about in his memoirs that by the time they were done, they had better horses than they started out with. They had two or three times more cattle than they started off with. Remember, this is, you know, 150 years ago. And they drove a cattle herd along to feed the troops. And basically, everything they started out with, when they ended up, they had everything better and more of. And that was all by taking it from the civil population. To this day, if you go to that part of the country, anyone from that part of the country, Sherman is considered Satan, okay? And this is, you think, man, it's 150 years. It don't matter. He destroyed that area of the country so bad that to this day they curse and spit his name. Well, I don't know. Do you curse and spit his name ever? But okay, he does. It's not a joke. He caused so much hardship. Now, I put up their misuse. He will say, yes, that's misuse of the census. Now, if you're a northern sympathizer, that was good planning. Right? You're going, yeah, that's a good idea. Good idea. That's the way to do it. Now, moving on, because we're probably running low on time, let's talk about Germany. Okay? Now, this was before the Nazis. Now, we all hate Nazis, right? If you don't, if you do like Nazis, I'm sure you can go out back here in a line with form and, you know, we'll kick your butt. I'll have to be in the middle somewhere because I'm old and fat, but, you know, if you're a Nazi sympathizer. But before the Nazis, the German government gathered all this information on its citizens. And it asked, obviously, we're getting to the Nazis, it asked all kinds of personal questions, right? And good old IBM, anyone a fan of IBM? IBM helped him out. This was in the early days of computers, right? I don't know, I'm not a techie. I can't remember the name of the computer they used or the sorter. But IBM helped the German government, helped the Nazis, and there's a couple books on this, end up killing 8 million people. Now, we hear a lot about 6 million people. Those are 6 million Jews. But what's overlooked a lot is there's 2 million other people killed in those camps, everything from religious people to homosexuals to, I mean, anybody that was outside the mainstream, gypsies, they could all be put in the camp. And the way they did that basically was through the census. All right. You guys have probably heard of this too. We'll try to get through it real quick. This is another misuse, possible misuse of the census. And I say that, and I probably got, well, what do you mean possible misuse? I'm on the Oklahoma War Archive Board. And when I talk to these old people who've been in the war, World War II is what I'm talking about, at that time they really thought, you know, the first couple years of the war, they thought there's a great possibility that they were going to lose, okay? They just had these huge losses all over the world. And it wasn't clear cut that the Japanese and the Nazis were going to be defeated. And so with that in mind, you have to understand what they did. I wasn't alive then, and I don't know what I would have thought. Now today we look at and say, oh, they rounded up all these poor Japanese, had nothing to do with anything. Well, you got to look at the times. You know, I'm not making excuses for them, but I know talking to these older people, they were scared. Okay, and this wasn't Iraq. Okay, this was the whole world was at war, and there was a question whether or not our country was going to survive. Well, anyway, they used the census information to round up all these Japanese. Okay, they also rounded up 11,000 Germans and Italians. Now I don't know why such a big probably because we just had so many Germans and Italians in America, you can round them all up like you could the Japanese. But the thing I found interesting in researching this, as you can see there. December 7th, 1941, we were attacked. What's really interesting, and this is for you conspiracy buffs, that they produced a report on the 9th of December and on the 10th of December describing the locations of the Japanese. Now, we could do that today with our computers, right? I mean, we could just real quick. But I don't know if or how they were able to produce those reports. I mean, we're talking the era of filing cabinets and typewriters, and they were able to produce the names and information about every Japanese within 2 days after Pearl Harbor. I don't know. Any conspiracy theorists out there? I thought it was interesting. Okay, they were using computers? Okay. Well, I'm not a techie. The old card sorters. Okay. Okay. Still 2 days. I mean, I don't know. Maybe I'm just too suspicious. 2 days is awful fast for 1941, I would suspect. But you know, people were scared. Yeah, smart ass. People were scared. All right. Misuse of the census. Epic. Anyone ever heard of them? I'm stuck in the 90s. 2004. Epic filed a FOIA request, remember, Information Act request, and wow, what did they discover? They discovered the Department of Homeland Security had asked for information on people from Arab descent, okay? Now, once again, I put it up there to let you guys decide, was this good or bad, okay? Now, I'm going to tell you this story. I teach criminal justice, and I have a diverse population in my classes. And one of the things we talk about is race profiling, okay? And usually we have a pretty good discussion because I do have blacks in there and Hispanics and whites and Indians and everything else. We have a pretty good discussion. And in fact, what really startled me was usually, you know, like I said, you know, everyone can agree and say race profiling is a bad thing, except for Arabs. And I looked at my class and I said, what? I said, what are you talking about? Well, you know, if you're waiting in line at the airport, right, and we all did that, And there's a couple Arab-looking guys. I think they need to be checked. And I, well, I don't know. And the interesting thing was, this is a young black man who's telling me this. I said, well, you know, I got to ask you, you're a young black man. Have you ever been a victim of racial profiling? He says, yeah. Yeah. But that don't matter. If you're Arab and you're in the airport. And I said, okay. Now, we laugh, and you might think that's bad, but, you know, there's a comedian on Comedy Central last month that I was preparing this, the same night I was preparing some of this. He was talking about it. He goes, you know, yeah, I sit on an airplane, and if I see an Arab-looking guy, he's back behind me, I'll turn around, I'll stare at him the whole plane, whole plane ride just to watch him, you know. And that's probably kind of true, okay? Now, I know some of you, you're not being very politically correct, but, you know, let's face it, if some Arab-looking guy came in here, dropped a backpack right in the middle, and said, Allah is great, and ran out the door, only the people sleeping would still be in their chairs, probably. Okay? Now, I'm not saying it's right, okay? I'm just saying it's human nature. Now, what about this? Is this legal? Is this legal? How could the Department of Homeland Security request this information? How could the Census Bureau give it to them? And the answer is, it's legal. It's legal. Now, they didn't give individual names, but what they did is gave they produced this big list of the population centers with Arab communities. And, of course, when crap hit the fan, the excuse they gave was we wanted the data in order to determine where to place Arabic language signs in airports. Now, we all flew here, or many of us flew here, and I want you to do this on the way home. When you get to your airport, I already checked, there's none in Las Vegas. When you get to your airport, wherever you're going, look for those Arabic signs. I don't think you'll probably see any. I don't know. Anyone see an Arabic sign at the airport on the way? Oh, got one. What city? Okay, Kansas City?
I'm out of Detroit, and there ain't one in the airport.
Okay. Okay. So maybe it was only the Kansas City office that got that memo.
Only on the entrance, when you come in, there's a welcome sign that's in about 15 different languages, and there's one on the exit that's also saying, leave.
All right. I went to law school in Kansas City, and... So I spent 3 years there, and I don't know. I've seen a lot of this town. I don't remember too. You know, it's 10 years ago, but I don't remember too many Arabic people there. But you know, maybe that's changed.
Dallas,
Washington. Is that okay? DC, they do have one. Okay, they're hidden. All right. What is the privacy policy of the Census Bureau? Well, the privacy policy is that it is against the law. They can actually receive a pretty hefty fine of $5,000 if they actually, and they'll tell you this, they'll tell you they're pretty proud of that. No census worker has ever given out any personal information on anybody. It is against the law. It is against the law to reveal any private information about an individual. Now, what they did in the Homeland Security case is they did not give it on an individual. They gave it on a community. Okay, and they'll tell you that about the Japanese roundup too. They said we did not actually give personal information on Japanese. We just told them what block they lived on. Well, years later, it was revealed they actually did give out names. Okay. Another real quick comment. There's a section on the Census website that talks about how they want to start organizing their data. And they would like, the Census Bureau would like to use Social Security numbers. And so they did a test run. They went out and they did a test run and they tried, when they selected a cross-section of the community or the country, and they ask them to fill in their Social Security number, and then they ask them how they felt about it. And believe it or not, the majority of Americans have no problem with giving the Social Security number over to the Census Bureau. Right now, they do not do that. The Census Bureau does not use Social Security numbers, but it's something they want to implement. And I'm thinking they might try it for the 2010 census. We'll see what happens. But keep that in mind. Right now, that is not the case, but the Census Bureau wants to. Potential misuse of data. Well, you know, you guys are hackers, and you know way more ways to take this type of data and use it. I just, what was the case? A guy How much money was he able to sell all those AOL email addresses for? Wasn't it a couple million or something like that? I don't know. There's plenty of ways. If you could get hold of this data, you could use it for all kinds of profitable means. In fact, the Census Bureau, if you go to their page right now, you can go through and look at some of the data right now. Okay. And there's companies out there that take this data and they crunch it, and they turn around and they sell it, and they sell it for a lot of money. The cheapest set of data discs that I've seen out there is around $300. Okay, so there is some potential out there. And I'll go out and say, well, Dunker told me to go steal from the Census Bureau. I'm not telling you that. So it's out there. And the trouble is, if you're concerned about your privacy, we know hackers never, ever get hold of private information, right? You guys, those of you who are good, never run across information accidentally or otherwise that is considered very private. The government, what kind of potential misuse of data can the government? Well, place of birth citizenship, we already seen that in the Homeland Security issue, right? Which, by the way, if you go to the Epic website, I mean, they took their FOIA request and the information they got and they posted it all. It's kind of interesting to read it if you have nothing else to do. You might drop by there and take a look at it. Language spoken. We certainly all can understand the idea of, you know, there may be some profiling there and that type of stuff. But I want you to think a little bit more about yourself. Now, some of you have special skills, special occupations. And if things ever got really bad, okay, and they started the draft up, and this is not going to happen anytime soon, but if they need your skills, what do? You get a little notice in the mail saying, guess what, you're now in the Army. Okay. Now, in the past, they usually did this like to doctors and dentists and stuff like that, right? Okay. But you know what? It's a new future, right? You guys, some of you have very good skills that the government would like to have control over. Okay. These, you know, we can see this now. You know, you guys, some of you are probably familiar. Some of you probably participated in this partnership between the government and private industry and, you know, securing the computers and stuff like that. That's one way they're trying to improve their security. But if things got bad, one of the things they would do is they just call you up, say, guess what, private? You know, hopefully they give you some rank, you know, right? The other thing, if you were really, really paranoid, okay, and I'm not really a paranoid guy, okay, sometimes I am. But I was talking to my doctor one day. He's a friend of mine. Our kids play on the soccer team. And this was back when they had the anthrax problems. And he told me, he goes, well, you know, the problem is that the government sucked up all the antibiotics. He said, what? He said, you know, this is like 4 years ago, for those of you keeping track. He says, well, there's nothing we can do because what the government has done, they stepped in and they grabbed all of the drugs that is used to fight an anthrax infection. I said, wow, I didn't know they could do that. And he said, yeah, they can do it. Because they went in, took everything. The only thing left was whatever's on pharmacy shelves. Everything in the warehouses, everything at the manufacturer was scooped up, and it was held in reserve for government officials. Okay? I don't know what counted as a government official, but you guarantee none of us did. Okay, maybe some of you feds, okay? But the rest of us, we weren't going to get any antibiotics. Okay? So, well, you know, what's that have to do with the Census Bureau? Well, you know, there hasn't been a lot in the last month about the bird flu, okay? But everybody in here knows or should know that was a Tamiflu. There's a shortage of it, okay? When it comes down to deciding who gets the Tamiflu, they're going to work their way down from the top, okay? Now, if you're like me, you're kind of screwed. No one wants to save a college professor. Now, especially a lawyer. Okay, lawyer jokes. You bastards. Former cop, they might save me. No. But you guys might have an advantage here. If you're some high security, high tech, I don't know, because, you know, I don't know the proper term because I'm a lawyer. I'm not a tech guy. but it may behoove you to fill out your census form and let them know how skilled you are in computers area. Because if they're going to thin the herd, so to speak, if they only have enough doses for half of America, right, and they have to decide who to give it to, they're not going to give it to the college professor. They're going to give it to the people that matter. Now, I'm not sucking up to you. I'm just kind of envious of you. If you got skills, you matter to America. Okay? The college professor lawyer's dead. The computer Uber technician lives. Okay? Something to think about. So those of you here with your boyfriend or girlfriend who has all the skills and you don't, just tell them goodbye now. Okay? Honey, can I have some of your Tamiflu? No. Physical characteristics of housing. Okay, this actually has been used against people in the past legally. And I don't think we'll get to it, but we got some cases that's in your folders, you'll see. Basically, what has been done is the federal government does a census, and then they publish it, and a lot of people can get hold of it. And some of the slimeball city officials in certain towns have got hold of this, and what they look for is some of the housing characteristics. As you know, especially some of your landlords, sometimes you're in violation of code, okay, for whatever reason. And this has been used in the past to attack... I don't know if that's a good word, to come after and kick people out of housing and to shut down rental houses and everything else because of these code violations, all obtained from the census. Now, it's not widespread. It's not, you know, like every town does it, but there has been some recorded incidences where they did use this census data to do it. IRS, can the IRS get hold of your census form? The answer is they tried. In fact, they had a big program where they were going to go through and attempt to find people, they say, who were not paying taxes. These people were not filing returns, and so what they wanted to do is use the Census Bureau information to locate and catch these people. Well, this was not successful. I'll tell you this, the main reason it was not successful is because the computers at that time were not up to the need. All right, any federal computer workers in here? Sometimes just getting one agency computer to talk to another one, there's a problem. And that's what one of the things that happened. All right, census laws will blow through this. All the way back in 1790, you could be in trouble for not doing the thing. I do want to talk about this. 1976, they tried to pass a law that actually lock you up if you did not fill out the census form. If you did not fill out the census form, you could get some time. If you filled it out with a false answer, you could get some time. It failed. Now, why did I bring that up? Because the amount of compliance with the census is going down. It has been. They got to do something. And I think probably we'll see something pop back up where they try to force people to fill out these census forms. This is the current law right here. Basically, it says if you give a false answer, and I blasted through another slide. Basically, if you give a false answer, you can be fined $500. That doesn't sound like a whole lot, right? Unless you're me. I'm a college professor. I don't make much money. $500 is a lot of money. Well, that's a slide I missed. It's $100, right? The slide before this that I blasted through basically says that if you refuse to fill out the form, you can be fined $100. Now, some of you go, oh, that's not a big deal. That's not a big deal, except the census people tell you that's per question. Per question. Now, the courts right now are, there's, you know, like I said in the very beginning, there's not a lot of cases on this, right? Now, you do the math. Let's say you refuse to fill it out. $100 a question. There's 36 questions for every member of your household. That's at least $3,600. If you're married, quick, someone do the math. I'm a lawyer, not a mathematician. Case law. Somebody going, well, you know what? This is an invasion of privacy. This is my Fourth Amendment rights. Well, actually, Mr. Rickenbacker tried that, and the court said, you know what? The government has a reason to do this, and so we're going to let them do it, right? That's pretty fancy lawyer talk there. The government has, that the bottom paragraph is right out of the holding, and basically the court says, it's okay, we'll let you do that. That was a 1960s case. Believe it or not, there were some rebels back in the 60s and 70s, and this particular group of rebels called themselves the Census Resistant Movement. The Census Resistance Movement. Now, hopefully this time next year, I don't know, is there going to be a Census Resistant Movement out there on the internet? I looked, it's not in existence now. One of you radicals will probably do it. I don't know, these two people are from Hawaii. They're probably still alive. They're probably in their 50s or 60s. And basically what happened was they were young folks, and they were living in Hawaii, and the census information came out. And basically they started this group that did all kinds of stuff. They began to publish editorials in newspapers. They went on the radio and had like little advertisements and so on and so forth. Well, the Census Bureau got pissed, okay? And they took four cases to the U.S. attorney, the prosecutor. And in fact, they were prosecuted. And in fact, they were found guilty. Now, the judges in those cases, and I know this is 72, 73, they were pretty lenient. They gave them $50 fines, okay? And even in today's money, that's what, like $250, something like that, okay? So it wasn't too bad. Well, Steele and Danks, they didn't like the outcome, so they appealed it. And basically, they argued several different things, okay? But the one they were successful on is they were being punished for their First Amendment rights. And actually, their cases were overturned because they were selected for this persecution, okay? I was looking more along the lines of example, okay? Now, I did, but it's still persecution. Now, when I was doing my sister's case, back to that for a little while, I happened to run into one of the top criminal attorneys in the state of Missouri. And of course, he doesn't know me from Jack, but I went up and asked a weird question because, you know, he didn't know me from Jack. And so I went up and asked him, I said, have you ever heard anyone being prosecuted for a census violation? And he looked at me and he said, yes. And I said, well, I can't find any on the books. Can you tell me where to find it? And he says, well, they're not on the books. What usually happens is every time around census time is they'll make an example. They'll go to every state and make an example of anybody who refuses to do this. And they'll put it in the newspaper and make a big publicity out of it. Now, remember this, though. There's 300 million people here in America. Two-thirds fill out the form. One-third doesn't. You do the math, right? What are your chances of being that one person? Well, I guess it could happen, but if you become a census resister, right, you might go after that thing. Well, they prosecuted me. It was prosecutorial misconduct selecting me for this. No one else got it. So I guess that might be able to save you a little bit, but I wouldn't count on it. This is in Hawaii, and that case is only good in Hawaii. So what do? They come, they knock on your door. They're badgering you. Now, this is where I don't want to get in trouble because I can't encourage anyone to commit a crime. So I'm going to tell you all right now, fill out your census form and turn it in. Okay. Now, with that out of the way so they don't prosecute me, I'll tell you this. What do you do if you refuse to answer? Can they do anything to you? What have you learned today? Do you give false answers? Everyone shake your head no. Do you remain silent? One of the mistakes, and I did ask my sister this, I said, why did you answer that phone? You got caller ID. She said, because it did not say U.S. Census Bureau on it. Now, let's say that you decide to do one of these, or refuse to answer. Hopefully you do not give false answers, because that's a bigger risk, right? You decide to remain silent, so on and so forth. What will the census people do to you? Well, as I looked to the internet for that answer, I really didn't find a whole lot. I did find some anecdote. I mean, some people saying, oh, I did it, and they just went away. I can't guarantee that, okay? But what I can guarantee you is if you don't do anything, they will go talk to your neighbors. Believe it or not, the census Gestapo will show up at your house. If you don't talk to them, they'll go next door and they'll say, hey, what's your neighbor do for a living? Hey, how many kids do they have? You know where he works at? What town? How far does he drive? Well, what's your electric bill here? And they'll go through the whole process of filling out the census form using the information from your neighbors. Now, some of you are going, well, my neighbors don't know anything about me. Okay, and that's probably good. But it is something to think about, right? They'll try to get it one way or another. All right. Now, I'm going to try this. And I got a question. Yes? I would say your neighbor has no liability at all. He want to know, what if the neighbor refuses to answer? They have no liability. As long as they filled out their own census form, they don't have any requirements to fill out anyone else's. Yes?
The person is someone who travels, you're bi-regional, you're on the West Coast for 6 months, and East Coast 6 months, and you're not there when all this stuff happens.
Sounds like a great defense to me. She says, what if you go traveling a lot? You're on the East Coast for a little while, West Coast for a little while. What are you going to be in trouble? And I said, I would say, the only thing I'll say is, sounds like a great defense. I mean, yes. If your neighbors really hate you and they give wrong answers, I mean, you're fine. I mean, you're not responsible for their answers, obviously. You're still responsible for not filling it out. Yes. Okay, it is federal prosecution. The U.S. Census Bureau is a federal agency, so they'll take it to the U.S. Attorney's Office and file federal charges against you. I wouldn't say that's your only obligation. You're obligated to fill out the form they sent you, is the way I read it. Okay. Now, I will tell you this real quick, that a lot of people got upset and they called their senator and their congressman. Okay. Now, what is interesting, and I don't know the reason for this, but the Republican senators, and I'm from a Republican state, they replied, and it's in the newspaper. Now, this doesn't keep you out of getting a fine, but most of the Republicans said only fill out the first six questions. And the first six questions are your name, your race, you know, that, the basic stuff that, you know, they need to decide on the number of representatives from your area, you know, in Congress. Anything other than that, don't fill out. And all the Democrats, for whatever reasons, were silent on this. They didn't say one way or another anything. Oh, fill it out or don't fill it out. And I'm not sure what's going on with that because I'll tell you right now, don't throw stuff at me. I am a Republican, but, you know, yeah, I know. Anyway, this is Democrat territory. Usually it's the Democrats saying, oh, we want to protect people's rights. You know, we want to make sure, you know, their privacy is protected. But now all of a sudden, it's the other way around. What's going on? I don't know. Republicans saying, no, that's invasion of your privacy. Don't fill that out. You know, big government doesn't need to be in your life, blah, blah, blah. And now all of a sudden, Democrats are going, yeah, it's okay. Just do what you're told. Yes. You know, that's a good question. It hasn't been in court at all. You know, like I said, there's been very few cases. The trouble is with this is most people, when they go to court, it's kind of like a traffic ticket. You pay your $100 and you don't appeal it. Well, when you don't appeal it, there's no record of it. Not all court cases are wrote in the books. And when you don't appeal it to a higher court, it doesn't get wrote into the books, okay, or written in the books. Yes. He wanted to know the people who don't respond, what kind of data is collected and recorded. I don't know. I did want to do this. If you have more questions, you come up. I think I've probably got like 3 minutes left or something like that. And I want to screw with the other two rooms, okay? And what I want to do, I need some tech help from this. This came to me in the middle of the night. I don't know if it's going to work. But we want to screw with everybody else that's not in this room, okay? We want to make them think that somehow your DEFCON badges have been compromised at the manufacturer. The DEFCON people had nothing to do with it. They, in fact, were owned also. But somehow the NSA or somebody else has put in an extra circuit here that enables it to be tracked. Now, once again, I'm not a techie. You guys are going to have to fill in the blanks to convince these other rooms that this is a possibility. Now, I realize we're not going to fool a whole lot of people, but, you know, there's a lot of paranoid people in this world, okay, and at this convention. So this is a secret, right? We're not going to tell anybody. What I want you to do is go out and discuss this around people who are not here, okay? Oh, man, I can't believe that. And we'll make up a story. This is a story we're going to make up, that my talk was interrupted by some tech head. He comes running up here and he says, I've x-rayed the badge and I found this hidden circuit and I've explored it and this is what it looks like. We've been tagged like animals. RFID, says the tech heads. We have all been tagged like animals. And some unknown agency out there is going to track us to our homes. Okay? And the only way to stop this is tinfoil. Okay? Tinfoil is the only way to stop this government tracking of us. Okay? Now, I don't know. Like I said, we're just, you know, I realize, I don't know how many people are in here, maybe 1,000. That still leaves 5,000 in the other rooms. Okay? You know, if we can just screw with 200 people. Okay? If 200 people can go home with tinfoil on their badges, I think we've accomplished our goal. Right? So once again, it is a secret, right? All right, he says the battery can make it an active RFID that can be tracked up to a mile, okay? Like I said, I'm not a tech guy. I'm relying on you guys, right? Spread this story. You know, you got to don't come out and say, let's see what happens. Let's see if I mention it at the wrap-up ceremony in a couple hours, right? So just drop this information. Let your friends squirm, you know. Yes. Oh, someone's actually going to use a microphone.
You mentioned you can get the data from via CD. At one point, you could also get it from their site via FTP.
Okay, everyone hear that? You can FTP to the site. You can actually just go there, you know, with your browser, HTTP, whatever protocol that is. I'm a lawyer, not a tech guy. I will say this, because I did leave this part out. Right now, one of the things my client, my sister, was worried about is she lived in an area. Her house is among all these businesses. She's one of those holdouts, right? She bought a house, and the businesses grew up around her, and she was worried that when you look at the census block, the census track, that you could find out any information you could about her because she was the only residential area or residential home in this area. And so I was concerned about that, and I looked it up, and I asked a professor who operates in this area, and he says, no, what they do is when they have that, when they have the information where you can actually look at one house and you figure, well, I can, you know, correlate that to the data, what the census is supposed to do is flip that. In other words, they insert false information from another census block into her area, and they take hers and stick it over here. It doesn't throw off the numbers enough to matter, they say, but that way you're not getting really personal data. It's not an individual thing. But then my thought was, well, yeah, now they just have false data that they think is hers, right? You know, it could be bad. Maybe the person on the other end is, you know, troublemaker or something. Yeah. Oh, yeah, the end of the story is I'm telling her, all right, just hold on. I'll get to the bottom of this. And then one day I called her up. I hadn't heard her from, you know, lawyers take a while, right? I called her up, and she says, I just went ahead and gave them the data. I can't afford to lose that much money. I couldn't, you know, even $100 I couldn't do. And so I just I just caved in and gave him the information.
This isn't census, but what about voter registration and precinct size and whether you voted and your affiliation to a party when you go to a primary? To me, it seems you can get down to pretty close who's who and who's voting and who's voting for who.
You know, I think that's true, you know, and I'm running out of time. One thing, I'm actually in my area of the country, Oklahoma, you can go vote without an ID. And this actually kind of, I wonder, well, how do they know who I am? All I do is I go in and I sign my name, right? And then I get to vote. That's about right. I mean, this is Oklahoma politics, and, you know, I don't know, anyone have that same thing? I think you ought to at least show an ID, but other people said, no, you make them show an ID, you know, then you can track them or you can intimidate them or something like that. Yes, sir.
Have you seen the county level Global Information Services information that is available on most local county government websites?
You know, I haven't actually gone to one, but
they do the overflights in February. They can, you can tell what kind of flowers you have planted in front of your house.
Yeah, and you know, I'll tell stories on a guy I used to work with. He actually went out and camouflaged his new barn with the idea that, well, if you know what he's talking about, they're going around taking photographs, and they use that to determine your taxes. And so he couldn't afford the netting to put over his barn, so he went up and painted the roof. With the idea that, you know, if they showed up in the right season, you know, maybe they want to see the new barn. But go ahead.
What was the caller ID when they called your sister?
Unknown caller.
Unknown. Okay. Thanks.
Which I don't answer those anyway. Go ahead. I'm sorry. You can't get in trouble lying to them like you could lying to an FBI agent, or at least that's my opinion. Don't hold me to it. They actually are, anybody in here can be a census worker. They are temp workers, okay? And they usually get paid, it depends on what part of the country. In my part of the country, they get paid $10 an hour. Anyone in here dare raise your hand and say, yes, I was a census worker? but yeah, I think it's like $10 to $14 an hour. You're a temp, you go in, you work, you know, 20, 30 hours a week tracking these people down. And they're not doing evil. They're not evil people. They just wanted a job, right? You know, I didn't look to see whether a census worker could get in trouble for recording false answers. I bet you that that probably happens. Anytime you got pressure for somebody, you can to get a job done. All right, they're telling me I'm over. I appreciate you guys listening. Remember, it's a secret. Screw with the neighbors.